This is a router, or at least that's what it was designed to be. It has two network jacks in the back, and it runs a customized version of OpenWRT that you can use to make an open source router. It does all of that very well. But what if I told you we could ignore all of that router nonsense and use this to build a gaming console that has the ability to emulate GameCube, Wii, PlayStation 2, and Nintendo Switch? That's what I intend to do in this video. This is the NanoPi R6C, and I was initially interested in it because of how cheap it is. At $85 for the base package, this thing is half the cost of other boards that I own with this processor, and it's cheap enough to be a viable option as a low-cost emulation console. This little thing has way more power packed in here than it would ever need to fulfill its destined job as a router. If you own one of these and you want to follow along, there's not a lot that you need to get up and running. The cheapest version of this comes with 4 GB of RAM and no storage, so you will need a micro SD card at a minimum or an M.2 drive. If you're planning to play demanding systems like I am and you don't want to worry about throttling, you'll also need to pick up a heatsink of some kind. They sell a big one for $15 that works perfectly and you won't have to worry about any thermal issues, but you can also pick up very cheap heatsinks meant for the Pi for well under a dollar if you want to save more money. After that, we need to head over to the Friendly Elect website and go to their wiki page for this product. In there, you'll find documentation on almost anything you can think of, including software for this board. We could use Linux for this to also be able to play PC games with Steam, but GameCube and Wii emulation isn't really there right now for Linux, and we do not have a good option when it comes to Switch emulation. I'm gonna go with the Android 12 build because that will allow us to make the most out of this hardware. If you're flashing an SD card, the process is super easy, and all you'll need to do is use the included Disk Imager app to write the image to the card. I'm going to flash the eMMC on my board, and it's a bit more complicated because you will need a USB Type-A to Type-A cable. These are not that common, but I already had one of these from another project. After the flashing finishes using the Rockchip tools, we can boot up the device to see what we're working with. I'm using a wireless 7-inch screen for this that also supports touch. I made a video on this a while back, but this is the final version with the upgraded screen, and it's pretty awesome even if it is super niche. The touchability will make it a little easier to set up some of the apps and emulators. So it looks like we have a standard Android 12 build here, and not a whole lot is pre-installed. That's actually a good thing because it means we won't have to worry about a lot of overhead. The system appears to have Google Play installed, but I cannot test it without a VPN. I also don't know if this system has root access, but I hope that it does because it will allow us to get the most performance possible out of this hardware. I now need to add all of the software that I'll need for the rest of this video off camera. I'm essentially going to be sideloading everything that I need. This board has a single USB 3.0 port, and I'm planning to use that with an external hard drive that will hold all of my ROMs. Through the magic of editing, I now have the entire device ready to go, but I want to go over some quick benchmarks before we jump into the titles. For Geekbench 5, I got a single core score of 558 and a multi-core score of 2328. I couldn't get the GPU test to work in Geekbench, so I opted for 3DMark and I was able to get a decent score of 4519 in the Wildlife benchmark. Now we are ready to start looking at performance of this little router SBC. I have this hooked up to a wireless 7-inch screen right now with Joy-Cons for input, and I was able to use root access to change the CPU and GPU frequencies. CPU 6 and 7 are a little low with their max clock, but it shouldn't impact these titles in a significant way. The GPU is more important, and that was able to clock up to 1 GHz without any problems. Our first system is PS1 with the DuckStation emulator. I have the rendering resolution set to 5x native with PGXP turned on.
Pass it on.
PSP is our next system. I have the rendering resolution set to 3x, but I probably should have gone to 4x to max out this 1080p panel. Either way, the system runs great on this. Now we're up to one of the bigger systems that I wanted to test on this little board. Here's PS2 emulation with the Aether SX2 emulator. It's been a few months since the last time I used this emulator on Android with this processor, but I'm not expecting any big changes with the current version of Aether SX2. I heard through the grapevine that there might be some changes to this emulator that improves performance on this processor, but I don't know when that will drop. I set the default rendering resolution to 2x native, but we probably could have gone up to 4x native for some of these titles if we wanted to min-max. This is still a great little SoC for PS2 emulation.
Well, they do say clothes make the man. You look like...
Here's another big system that I wanted to test on this board. This is GameCube emulation using the official Dolphin emulator. Unfortunately, I was not able to get the MMJR versions to work due to some issues that they have with devices that use an external screen, so I had to use the official one. I have the rendering resolution set to 2x for this, but I would have been able to go higher for a lot of these games if I was able to use the MMJR builds. When it comes to Wii emulation, we are still on the official Dolphin build with the same rendering resolution. I don't usually go for the official build with a Mali GPU, but I was able to get some bigger Wii games to run well on this board. Our last system for this video is one of the biggest, and it's also one that I haven't tested on the 3588 in a long time. This is the latest build of the Skyline Edge emulator, and I am kind of surprised at how things are shaping up. A bunch of games that ran very poorly before are nearly flawless now, but I'm still holding out hope that we will get a lot more 3D games to run on this without graphical issues. Yes.
Thank you.
Anyway, that's going to be it for this short little video on the NanoPi R6C. This is a great little budget board that can fit a bunch of different project ideas, or you can just use it as a router if you want. I think this is a very good deal at $85, given the fact that the processor alone goes for almost half that price. Hopefully, we will see this in handhelds and home consoles later in the year. Happy gaming, everyone. Taki out.